I think that as we move into our last panel, here we are on 9/11, 11 years after 9/11, and we are having a conference on free speech at the UN, and we are living under the security that was mandated for this conference 11 years after 9/11. People don't even really, they're not even cognizant how shocking that really is. We've become inured to the Islamization and encroaching Sharia of in America. And my next speaker, I think, is iconic of this fight. I see Mr. Vilks as sort of the accidental counter-jihadist. You know, one day he was doodling, and the next day, you know, they were chasing him with rocks and axes. And, you know, I don't know that Mr. Vilks and I share the same political philosophy. I don't know how much Mr. Vilks and I have in common, except a basic love of freedom and our unalienable rights. And so I am honored to be able to introduce you to my next guest, who has lived under threat 24/7. He has constant guards merely for, you know, creating a rather, if I might say, innocuous cartoon. I don't know that people know what a brilliant painter he is or his other skills, but the fact that he dared draw a cartoon has made him, as you can see right in front of me, an object of scorn, derision, and in the media, perennial curiosity. So it is my honor to introduce you to the Swedish cartoonist Lars Vilks. Thank you. Thank you so much.
My name is Lars Vilks, and my point of view is actually art. And that means I'm not a politician, I'm an artist. And what is the difference? Well, the difference is that I work with distancing things, looking at things, making presentations, and dealing with projects. And when I make an artwork, it's always a possibility that it will actually become what is most interesting for me, a process work. And so 5 years ago, I made a drawing called A Traffic Roundabout Dog.
Similarity is not exact, I would say.
Let's see, as we come into the roundabout dog, because I made a drawing of the roundabout dog, and every time I speak to a non-Swedish audience, I have to introduce the roundabout dog. That was a folk art movement spontaneously that came about in 2006 in Sweden. People started to make small dogs in different materials, and anonymously they went out in traffic roundabout and put the dogs there. And they did that all over Sweden. Yeah, that's what people were doing in 2006 in Sweden. And everyone loved those things, the traffic roundabout dogs. And what then happened was that I was invited to a very small exhibition called The Dog in Art. And there was, of course, this subject that I was interested in, and that was dealing with Islam, freedom of speech, political Islam, that had came about 2 years earlier with the Danish cartoons. I have to then add just that I was presented as a cartoonist here, but I have still not done any cartoons in my life, but I'll think about it. there is a slight difference between artist and cartoonist. Anyway, I made this drawing, and the subject was then the Prophet Muhammad as a roundabout dog. Yeah, I'm just doing that. We just hope we have a connection here. should have the technician here. Do we have a hope, or I do I have to... This is the piece I made. And the strange thing with this is, of course, that it's quite a ridiculous piece. And we can also say that the reason I'm standing here today is that I made this. But now the thing is that when I make a thing, I have the interest of making a process work. Normally, there will not be very much process of an artwork, but in this case, it came to an enormous process that still is developing. And the dog and what happens to it is still as controversial as it was 5 years ago. I don't know how to end this, really. But one can be optimistic about that, because there will always be an end. So it's rather the beginning that is the problem. And here was a kind of clear beginning with this dog picture. Many people claimed said it was a bad drawing. The thing is that, I mean, it is not a bad drawing. It should look like that. That was what I meant. But what happened with this thing here was that it didn't, as I supposed it to be, it would remain in the art world. Because my thing was to just point into the art world that the freedom, the total openness. At that time in 2007, I said, everything is done. Everything can be art, all gates open. And when I was thinking about that, I came to the idea that the only thing you need to do is to draw this little roundabout dog and everything will crack, which was, of course, the case, because you can't do things like that. Art today is mainly about social and political issues, but within the standards of art. But you have also subjects which you do not touch, and one of these was then Islam. And I mean, I didn't expect anything more than in the local art world this would maybe be found some sort of unusual, a bit provocative, etc. But then things unexpectedly started to happen, and the first thing that happened was that these people who were going to make the exhibition, they were very satisfied with this, because I explained my ideas. And I also said that, well, we had this this thing with media interest in Denmark, and there will be no repetition. The media is tired of this subject now. And actually, I also had made a few drawings from the same subject, which I exhibited in Oslo, and that was in a big exhibition. And there was no reaction from that, so I said, this is something we can take internally. But all right, they put them up, and then in the last moment they took them down, because suddenly they feared for that something bad could happen. And that came out in the media, so people started to asking me, is it impossible for a gallery, museum, to exhibit what they want? And so started my process work. So, and this is a very important point. I mean, when you have a process work, it is a vehicle that goes through a landscape and creates a constant ongoing performance and makes everyone that comes in touch with that a part of the artwork. So now you can consider yourself sitting in an artwork and being a part of this process work. So everything you do here is a kind of performance art, and it has developed a bit. And is there a point with this? Because it looks like the reality. I mean, if we look at each other, we are still looking about the same as we was a few seconds ago. But I mean, the possibility that an artwork offers is that you can look in another way, because you didn't think about looking at your neighbor as an artwork. And Mr. Hedegaard, he looks like this when he's not right. That creates a kind of reflection. Because my point of view is not to pin down opinions. I just try to register my trip. And I offer this to an audience. And then you can reflect upon it. and you can make your own judgment, you can make your own interpretation, and the spectator actually creates the work. So, I mean, this was this one I made here was then not liked by people. People said that, well, if it had been a good drawing, then it would be different. So I made a more academic version. And what happened when you made the academic version? No one was interested. And that's one thing. I've done very many versions of it, but it has not added something. No one has ever said they've been insulted of the other ones, because I mean it's a symbolic thing. And quite occasionally, I mean people sometimes they ask me, this is not done for this occasion. It looks like that, but actually there was a person asking me, is it possible for you to make an oil painting of my favorite graffiti artist Banksy, and bring together this with a roundabout dog? So I made this version here. And here's another one. It's a Warhol version. they're quite funny. But one important point is that it is not about the matter. I mean, whatever you do like this, it has already been done, because it's the first picture, not even the look of it, but the symbolic appearance that is to count on. Another fantastic story here, because, I mean, you normally get away with insulting the prophet. I mean, I was trying to push this in the art world, and suddenly it came outside the art world and started to be discussed, but normally discussions, they slow down after a while. But there was an interest in the Swedish newspaper. You can understand, at that time, 5 years ago, it was possible to print such a picture of the prophet in a newspaper, a reasonable newspaper. Today you can't. That's the difference. That's what has been taking place for 5 years. You cannot today. And maybe it's my fault. And you can say it's good for my project also, because it tells us something about our time. Anyway, I'm not sad for that. I mean, you can find it on the net if you're interested. Anyway, this picture shows a newspaper that printed it. Several newspapers, among them two of the Swedish big newspapers printed it. Nothing happened. But when it came to a smaller newspaper, there were demonstrations. And what then happened was that it spread also to the Middle East. There were, yeah, you see here is protests against this picture in Pakistan. They have the Swedish flag, or they're not sure about the Swedish flag. It should be actually blue, but they thought it was green. Never mind. I have done a pedagogic example today in the Middle East when they protest. There was a new protest in 2010, and they had the right flag. And I think Larish, that's my name. One can question this demonstration. I mean, if they were a real demonstration, or if they were kind of stand-up comedians in a way, ordered by the state. You don't know, because you don't see how many they are, etc., etc. Many things there are organized. But you can understand my idea of the process. It suddenly worked out like that. And I was new in the game, so I was a bit impressed when President Ahmadinejad, he made a statement about my drawing. I think, oh yes, I've done a roundabout dog, and now it's time for President Ahmadinejad to come with a view here. Review of this thing, and he said, "I'm sure it's a work of the Zionists, because they are the Zionists. They are behind the picture, because they don't want Sweden to be friend with other countries." So he said, and everyone was happy with that. because that's their normal standards. One form of protest which I like very much is these Egyptian guys which contacted me. We had discussions. I mean, they were a bit angry, but I mean, we discussed things. And they said that, all right, you have insulted us, we will insult you back. And so they made this one here, and it's very nice. I mean, this is the civilized way. This is the way we should do things. Yeah, it is. I mean, that's very good. I mean, I can, yeah. I just make a small parenthesis here, because when you, for example, in the U.S., when you make blasphemy against Christianity, they don't try to kill the artist. They take them to court, and the artist always win because you have a strong freedom of speech here. And then when they have lost in court, they take away the fundings from the gallery or museum, and they kick the curators. And then life goes on as usual. But there is one additional fact. It is that there will be strong demonstration, protest, and this work will be known, so that the art will win in that case. There will be no violence. That is not really the case here. But this was an interesting... actually, there is another one. This is also Egyptian drawer. I'm making this one. I was very happy that they actually produced these things. It fits into my... And then it came to the fatwa. I was very. It was very strange to get the first fatwa, and when I'm worth $150,000 if you cut my throat. It's in a way good to know what value you have. I was in Kassel in Germany when they called me from the news and said that we have bad news, and that was this thing here. Yeah. And also the editor of the newspaper that I printed, one of the newspapers that printed this. And so I came back, and as I was new in the game, I thought this was very dangerous, and maybe I'm going to be killed the next hour, but they work very slowly there. So I got in contact with the Swedish secret police, but they didn't give me so much support, so I have to find my own ways of hiding away or... Yeah, things actually after some time calmed down. And it came to the fantastic thing that this drawing, it has been exhibited in a real good museum in Lucerne in Switzerland. And there was no trouble. And you say, how is it possible? One, the art world actually exhibited. Number two, no trouble. And this is just the way to do it. I mean, this was an exhibition called Art is a Risky Business. It was very suitable for that purpose. And how to avoid problems was that they made no announcement whatsoever about this being included in the exhibition. No one knew that it was there. So then you will have no trouble. That's one way. You don't have to tell anyone. So... so only those who visit the museum can maybe see it, because the drawings are in that box there. And there is a warning sign on the wall that if you open this, it could be a terrible experience. I thought that this process work was actually a kind of historical adventure. But in 2010... it actually started to be like being in a musical. Jihad Jane. This is Jihad Jane. Colleen McRose, yeah. She was a part of a plot that took place in Ireland. So it spread geographically, really interesting. Jihad Jane from Philadelphia. And she has actually accepted her sentence. And she will be in court this autumn. So there was something behind it. But of course, it was kind of strange, you know. This murderer woman, blonde Philadelphia woman, moving around in Europe looking for the artist. That was, I mean, it's a good piece of fiction. And when that then happened, I became known again, and this is in Indonesia. It's an uncivilized artist, but yeah, I mean, there's nothing to say about that. That's how things are. They are giving their opinion. So that's not the knives, it's the science. That's how we want to have the dialogue. And they burn the Swedish flag. Now they have the right colors. And then came something which I've been accused of, and that was the Uppsala incident. I was invited to present my project, my process work, as I said. This is a story, it's a development, and I'm very keen on that, saying that I have a presentation of something which is a story, a narrative about our time, and one can do conclusions of it. I look upon it as kind of fictional, the object, and I'm trying to avoid giving specific opinions about where I stand. And that is one of the things that people are trying to nail me down. Where do we have this Mr. Vilks? What does he believe? Where does he belong? And I say he doesn't belong anywhere. So he's an outlaw. Outlaw wherever he goes. That's the life of an artist. So we are like that. Nothing, no harm done. At this presentation I should make at the Uppsala University in Sweden, I had to give an introductory speech about provocation in art. And provocation in art is actually history of art, because it's provoking new ideas and new forms. And I was then interested in this artist, Sora Hera, an Iranian artist, who had made a video about homosexuality and religion. And that one should first have been shown in Holland, but it was censored. And when I saw that, so then I saw that here we have a possibility to show exactly where are the borders of art today. And I said, this video here cannot be shown. There's no art biennial or a reasonable museum that are able to show it. YouTube cannot have it. They will also take it away. And it's not that strange. It's about homosexuality, but there is rumors then that it should be. You should see pornographic scenes in it. But there is actually nothing that is really embarrassing. But there is this connection between Islam and homosexuality. So here I have entered the room, and to my surprise, there was a lot of Muslims that was interested in contemporary art, because this was a series of quite advanced lectures in contemporary art, experimental contemporary art. And these guys sitting there was obviously newcomers in this field. And they were doing a fantastic performance, you could say, in a sense. And it went on. Here is the picture that actually showing. If you look closely, you should find me moving around there somewhere, because they stormed the audience here, and that became a fight with the bodyguards and the police and Muslims. Here, see, they are moving in. And so this is the audience, and they had to interrupt the lecture. There was a retake. A couple of months later, I could make this lecture, but then with an enormous police security. It has never been so much, you know. Even helicopters was moving around over the university. And, I mean, everything was closed, and it was done. Really an overkill of that thing. A few days later, I suppose the most serious attempt came about, and that was when there were two guys who, they came with knives and petrol, and they crashed one window and pour petrol inside and lit fire. They thought I was at home because my car was parked outside the house, but I was unfortunately not that. Here is a burning mark in the ceiling, but they were interrupted by a strange occasion, and that was they had some pet bottles, and when they used that for petrol, it came back upon them. So one of them set really bad fire, and they panicked in that situation, and ran away. They left the driver's license, keys, dentist cards, and one of them has to be taken to hospital. And they had their explanation was that they had a barbecue party, but they were sentenced for this thing here. I was in a way very lucky because when you make a process art and you take things humorously, because this one ended in a very humorous way. I mean, the only thing that actually was hurt here, I lost one curtain, and I just have one at my window now, but I can move this round as I please. One of my plants, but it recovered. It was badly burned, but I really nursed it, so it was recovered. I mean, I try to look upon things like that. That it's like a fiction. It's like a fiction. It's a story that that I have a distance to. I participate partly, but it's not real reality. I make it into art, and this was a kind of. It ended up with a comedy. Could have been a tragic. Here we have the Al-Shabaab man. You can read it. He's very tough, you know. He says a lot of things there. He sends you this warning. He's standing in Somalia, and he's speaking Swedish. So he has been up here. There's a connection between Al-Shabaab and Sweden also. He's cutting your throat on the slaughter of this. I understand he is trying to get some PR for his organization and hope that he finds some locals that will follow up the case. But, I mean, they are not totally to just be indifferent against. And, he gets my name. Kill this dog, I do have an exciting story, I would say. Here is blonde women trying to kill the artist. There's this Somali guy here standing with his gun and shooting now and then. And everything you need. The most tragic moment was, of course, Stockholm bomber. And that changed my life completely. The Stockholm bomber, you see, then the project actually had casualty. Though this was a suicide casualty, so it was not occasionally something. But he addressed me also as one of his targets. He said that because of this swine, this pig, Vilks. And from that moment, the security police decided that I should have bodyguards around the clock. So since 2 years, I have been living with bodyguards, and that's my life today. It is not a tragedy. You can get used to it. And of course, I see this as also part of my performance. We enter the bodyguard section of the work. this is the letter to the bomber. He sent a letter to Swedish people, and you can see my name is there somewhere. This thing here, I think, is something you can learn from. Which actually shows how difficult things can be. And that was in March in a Swedish university where I was invited to speak about freedom of speech and presenting my own project. And when I did that, there were some Muslim attacking me with eggs. And I made a painting of that, but it's very true to the photograph that actually was taken, but I could compose it a little tighter with that. You can see there, my bodyguard, he takes the shot. I mean, that's the end. So he had to clean his suit next day. But I escaped without any harm. And these guys were then screaming and things like that. And, I mean, everyone said that this was unacceptable, etc., etc. But there was also a movement before I was arriving at this invitation. The Society for Young Muslims had protested that it was invited and said that they should actually try to stop it. I mean, they didn't want to use any violence, not at all. But the combination, you can see here that you have protests from young Muslims. I mean, they claim their right to express themselves, and there's nothing to say about that. And then you have these activists throwing eggs. Then you come, of course, to the aftermath. Who wants to invite such a fellow to a place where you can expect protests and accusement of racism or whatever, and there might also be a riot? I mean, yeah, you take another one. So nowadays, when I have to make a lecture, I have to go to New York. I mean, it's so far, it's so that's a kind of problem also with my lecturing, that I create troubles when I come. Yeah. But you have to. I mean, I have to accept these things. I'm not a pessimist, I'm an optimist. I think that my story and my very reasonable approach to it, I have not been. I have no paranoia. I have a lot of Muslim friends. I mean, I say that there are lots of Muslims who are actually religious, but they say this is just nothing to fuss about. So, I mean, it's a mixture of things, and I have no hate against Muslims. I mean, it's just a certain number and certain attitude of things that actually are creating these. And so optimistically, I must say that I haven't had any special interest in Islam. I mean, I just was caught into this because of my dog, and I make very, very many other projects, but everyone believes that the only thing I'm doing is sitting and making drawing of dogs and insulting Muslims, but that is not the case. You can say that actually the only thing I've done to insult was done in 2007, and this dog is still fresh, and yeah, that's what I could offer today, a fresh, insulting dog. And then you became a part of my artwork, and I hope you enjoy that. Thank you.